chains. Sin held me captive to sorrow and pain. Tears of frustration as love passed me by. Until the Master heard my heart's cry.
Grace, marvelous grace, I needed grace to pardon and make me whole. Grace, marvelous grace, flows from above, infinite love, marvelous grace.
I was downhearted, broken inside, praying for mercy with nowhere to hide.
There was a Savior searching for me. Grace overflowing set my soul free.
From above, infinite love. appreciate that great singing this morning. I want to welcome each family here to Temple Baptist Church this morning. We're so grateful that you're here this morning. If you're glad to be here, would you say amen? And we're looking forward to a wonderful day in the house of the Lord. It's been a wonderful, busy weekend. And the ministry's here. We're grateful and excited about what God is doing and what God is going to do throughout the course of the day today. We want to start off with a word of prayer and ask God for His blessings. We certainly need the Lord, don't we? We've got many families that are sick, and I want you to pray for them as they're dealing with sickness, and many watching online this morning. And we want to pray that the service will be a blessing to them. And then also for God to meet the needs of our church family, whatever those are, spiritually, emotionally, mentally. God has the answer for every need in the Word of God. And if we'll open up our hearts and allow God to speak to us, I believe He can meet your need today. And so let's pray and ask God to help us this morning in a powerful way. Heavenly Father, we love You. Thank You for allowing us to be here this morning. Thank You, Lord, for the wonderful weekend that we've already had, Lord, with the marriage refresher yesterday evening, and Lord, the adult and children's Bible classes this morning, and Lord, now time for worship. And Lord, I pray that You would help us in every way, Lord, to put aside every weight, Lord, every fault that would hinder us from just getting in and being a part of the services today. Lord, help us to have clarity of mind. Lord, help us to have a heart of worship this morning. Lord, I pray that You meet with us, Lord, in Your presence, the touch of God, the power of God. I pray that You would comfort our hearts, challenge us, whatever the need may be, convict us. And I pray that You'd use the singing. May You be exalted and magnified through every song, every word that's spoken. Lord, may it be about You. May nothing be said about us, but may it all be said about You. Help us to exalt You today. Have that in our heart and our mind. Bring us, draw us closer to You. And we'll thank You for what You do in our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. The choir's going to sing for us once again. I know you'll be blessed as you listen to them once again this morning.
Listening every moment.
once again, all over the building, we're going to worship from our hearts. And I believe in congregational singing. That is a biblical principle in the Word of God that we are to sing amongst ourselves. And I want you to sing out just as loud as the choir singing from your end. Let's lift our voices up to the Lord. He's worthy of our voice. He's worthy of our praise. And let's give Him our best this morning as we worship together. What a great song. Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Give it all you've got as we sing and worship together.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story.
Making your way back to your seat. We're going to sing that last verse together. I want you to lift your voices. Sing with us if you will. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior and happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Remain standing if you will. We're going to sing an old familiar hymn this morning, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. All four verses together this morning. I want you to lift your voices. Worship with us today.
Lost, but now
Church, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Amen. I love that singing. Thank you so much for singing from your heart this morning. We want to remain standing, and we're going to receive our offering this morning. Ushers, if you'll come forward at this time, please. And, you know, our giving is part of our worship, and it's a way to say, God, here is 10% of what I have brought in this week, and whether it's gifts or whatever it was or for my job, and I'm going to give that to you. And that's how the ministry goes forward. That's how we're able to purchase property that we just purchased, almost $500,000. And this is how we're able to keep the lights on and so many things. And you're faithful in your giving. I don't know who does and who doesn't. I don't sit down at my desk and try to figure out who's giving and chastise those who don't. That's not my responsibility. My responsibility is just to lead you to the Word of God. And that's what the Word of God teaches us. And it is not, it is a principle. And don't you love how God does things like that for us? He leads us in these directions, and because he wants us to do it because we love him. God wants us to give because we say, Lord, I want to because you've been so good to me. And this is a way of worship. And so you can give online, templebaptistchurch.info. Many people do that securely, and then also in the plate. Now, if you have given in the plate, if you have not yet received your contribution for your tax statement or for your taxes, your giving from 2023, they're over here beside the media desk on that table. They should have, it should be an envelope with your name on it. And so get that by there and see that if you haven't picked those up. And then also, if you've been giving online, you should have already received an email with that. If you have not received that via email by your giving online, please call the church office and let us know about that so we can help you with that. A couple things to pray for. Miss Judy Lewis's sister passed away. If you're here Wednesday, we made mention of that as she requested prayer for her sister that was not doing well, and she's passed away. That funeral will be tomorrow at 1 o'clock p.m. at Currytown Baptist Church down in Arcadia area, and there will be a visitation from 12 to 1. We're going to be leaving the church with a church van at 11:30 to just go down there for the visitation only. We're not going to stay for the funeral service, but just for the visitation. If you would like to ride the church van, please call the church office or text me, let me know, and we'd love for you to go along with that. Also, we appreciate Justin and Felicity Mayberry. They sit back here, and they've been visiting with us for quite some time, very faithful on Sunday mornings, and we're excited about them. And they're a blessing, and she will be, Lord willing, going to the hospital, and they'll be going home with a baby, Lord willing, this week. So I want you to be in prayer for them. And then also, we also have another young couple, Mike and Elizabeth, also with their first child, and they have their bag packed and ready to go at any time with that. And so I want you to pray with these and others they're expecting. We're thankful for them. And so I want you to pray for these that are having children and so forth in these days, okay? Also, a couple things that I wanted to run by you. If you're here for the very first time and have received a visitor gift packet, if you would be so kind to look inside there, even during our prayer, that's okay. If you have an opportunity to do so, look inside there. You should see a large visitor card, also a pen provided there. That's all yours, but if you'd be so kind to fill that visitor card out and place that in the offering plate when it comes by, we'd love to have a record of you being here with us this morning. And then also, just raise your hand real quick here if you have not yet received, you're here for the very first time, and you've never yet received a visitor gift packet. Would you raise your hand real quick? We'll try to get one in your hand. We try to get those when people come in. Okay, wonderful. And then also a couple things that I wanted to mention to you. We'll do our video announcements at the end of service, but a couple things. Easter is coming up next month. Our Easter Spectacular will be Saturday, March 30th from 11 to 1. We have hot dogs, big bounce houses, our big Easter egg hunt, 12 o'clock. We're very excited about this church and community event. I'm hoping and praying, you pray with me, that we'll be able to get grass and there's a new area and we could have it all out here on the new property. It would be wonderful, wouldn't it? And let's just pray for that end. But Easter will be on March 31st, and I want to encourage you to be here. If somebody invites you, hey, I want you to come and be with me for Easter service, you say, no, you come be with me. And okay, I want you to be faithful to your church. And let me mention this. A lot of times I'll say, let's be faithful. It is a biblical word. To be faithful, it means to be consistent. But I want to help maybe to better help us better understand what that means. When I say let's be faithful, I mean let's be here every service and not miss. Okay, so when I say let's be faithful to the Lord, I'm saying let's be here every time the doors are open and let's not miss. And what will happen is, and you're going to miss. We've got tons of people out sick today. You're going to miss. You can't help that. You're going to have a flat tire. Miss Amber Gross and Jody was having a flat tire on the way to church a few weeks ago. You can't help that, okay? You're going to have flat tires. You're going to be walking out. One of your kids are just going to throw up all over the kitchen. It's going to happen. You know, there's things like that. It's going to happen, and you just can't help it. And you're going to text pastor. You say, Pastor, I want to be there, but I just can't help it. But what you need to do is you need to plan that. You just need to plan, be here every service or whatever your schedule is. I understand some folks work. I understand that. But you need to have that mindset that I'm going to be here every service. You're not going to be able to because of life. But have that, because if you don't, you're going to miss one or two, and then it's real easy to miss another one or two. And then before you know it, listen carefully, you will miss a month, and then a month will be turned into 2 months. And pastor and 20 other people have reached out to you. And what's going to happen is you'll get totally out of church. And then some tragedy is going to take place in your life, and you're going to need the Lord. And you're going to feel really awkward about calling the pastor because he's reached out to you, or the deacons, or the Sunday school teacher, and you're going to feel really awkward, and then you're going to be without people to be around you, to help you. And so I'm just trying to help you. When I say be faithful, there's so many reasons for that. But what I really mean by that is let's be here, and let's not miss, and let's make that a priority, because here's the reason I'm saying all this. Life is so busy. I'm here about 7 days a week. I try to take off. It just doesn't work out. It just doesn't happen. There's always something comes about, a surgery or a funeral or, you know, and that's okay. And I want to be there for our church family. There's always something going on, and that's okay. That's okay. I'll make it through somehow. And I'm joking, but I'm just simply saying it's a busy life. It's a busy life. We got sports, you got kids in school, you got homework, you've got your job. People are making you work 12, 14 hours a day now. It's crazy busy. It's not like it was 40 years ago. I wasn't even there now. I wasn't even then, around then. But I understand it's not always been like that. But don't let God become number 10 in your priority list, or number 9, or number 7, or number 4, or number 2. Put him number 1, and you'll be glad that you did in years to come with your marriage, your children, and all these things. Don't put television shows and all of this, and I'm not trying to harp on folks today. I'm just simply saying be faithful. Be faithful to the Lord. Be consistent, because so many people are pulling for our time. Put God first in your heart and his church, and you'll be glad that you did, okay? Listen, if I was sitting there, I would want a pastor to love me enough to tell me that. and I do. And I hope you understand that I love you, and I'm telling you that because I love you. And but Easter, I don't know how I got on all of that. But anyway, Easter services this year, we're going to do things, something we've never done before. We're having two services on Easter. I asked you to raise your hand a few weeks ago if you could come at 8:30. I was floored at how many people raised their hand. We had 50, 60 people that raised their hand. Now, listen to me carefully. If you're in the choir, you can come at 8:30, but understand the choir's not singing at 8:30. We need you here at 11 if you sing in the choir. And so choir members, you need to be here at 11 o'clock. 8:30 service, there is no children's church, there's no junior church, there's no nursery, no wiggle worms. The choir will not be singing, but it will be the same message. We will have Easter special music. We have some great special music, and so instead of the choir, we'll have the Easter special music. So it's going to be a wonderful service. So if you raise your hand, we're planning on you being with us, okay? We've got your picture. We're not going to hold you to it, but if you raise your hand that you can come at 8:30, please help us with that. And this is what this is going to do. It's not a consistent basis. There's not a need for that at this point. Now, hopefully there will be it in the future. But the 8:30 service is a way that we can alleviate seats for the 11 o'clock service. And we're doing a lot of promotion. We just ordered 30 yard signs to go out all over our community. We just got a billboard in Clemens. Hundreds of people are seeing that each day for the next almost a month, 28 days here. And so we're just doing a lot of push. Easter's one of the biggest Sundays of the year where people start thinking about coming to church. And so what that 8:30 service is going to do is help alleviate. Now, if you want to come to both, you can. But we are trying to alleviate about 50, 60, 70 seats for the 11 o'clock service so first-time guests can come in and have a seat. They don't have to hunt for that, okay? So if you can help us with that, that would be very, very, very appreciative. So keep that in mind, if you will. We're not going to advertise. You're not going to see it on the screens. You're not going to see it on an outreach card or door hanger, 8:30 service. That's for our church to be gracious for Easter service, okay? Also, we've got some families joining and in the next few weeks, different Sundays. We had some more planning to join this morning. They're not able to be here because sickness, but if you would like to join, I don't necessarily come to people most of the time. I don't. If I do, it's just because I want you to know we want you. But if you would like to join our church, if you'll call the church office, you'll see me. I would love to sit down with you and help you answer any questions you might have concerning that, okay? All right, let's be faithful in our giving this morning. Let's pray over the offering, and then you can be seated this morning. Heavenly Father, we love you. Thank you for this opportunity to give. Lord, I pray that you bless each gift and giver this morning. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be a part of such a giving church. And Lord, you've been so good to us. And Lord, I pray that you bless now in a tremendous way in this area of worship. Bless the remainder part of the service, please. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. you so much. I love that and appreciate that so very much. I'm reminded of what the Bible says about music, and it says play skillfully with a loud noise. And I appreciate the skillfulness with which our instrumentalists play, and I appreciate that very much. And God deserves our best, doesn't he? And we ought to set forth our very best for the Lord in every service. Psalms chapter 68. In your Bibles this morning, I trust and hope that you brought your Bible. If you didn't, just listen carefully. And I want to help you with something this morning that the Lord has laid upon my heart. And I was a little bit more hesitant about this. And I was reading my Bible and my Bible devotions. The Lord spoke to my heart about this some weeks ago. And I just wrote it down, scribbled some outline down that the Lord laid on my heart. And I felt like the Lord wanted me to preach it this morning. It's a little bit more straightforward, a little bit more direct, dealing with some things. But I believe it will be a help to us this morning. Psalms chapter 68. I trust that everyone has had a wonderful Valentine's week with your spouse. And if you haven't got a spouse, see my wife. She'll hook you up. All right? No, I'm kidding. I'm joking. And that kind of thing gets you in trouble. And but anyway, Psalms chapter 68, and let's begin reading in verse number 1. The Bible says, "Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered, let them also that hate him flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melteth before the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God. But let the righteous be glad, let them rejoice before God, yea, let them exceedingly rejoice." I hope that can be found of you today. Verse number 4, "Sing unto God, sing praises to his name. Extol him that rideth upon the heavens by his name John. Rejoice before him." Notice verse number 5, "A father of the fatherless and a judge of the widows is God in his holy habitation. God setteth the solitary in families. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land." Let's pray. We'll have a song that we get right into the Word of God and the message this morning. Father, we love you. Thank you for your Word. Lord, I don't want to just, Lord, you know my heart. I don't want to go through the motions. I believe that there you do everything in order. And Lord, I believe there ought to be an order to the service, Lord. But Lord, I want there to be much liberty. And Lord, I don't want to just go through the motions this morning. Lord, I want you to do a mighty work in our hearts, even through the online ministry today. Lord, that you would do a mighty work in our hearts and minds, that you would draw us closer. Lord, that we would help our minds to just be focused upon you, that our hearts would be kind of like that good soil where the seed of the Word of God is able to get in there and to bring forth fruit, that there would be change, that there would be acceptance to your Word, Lord, and that we would apply it to our lives, implement it. Well, thank you for what you do. Bless the song and then the preaching of the Word of God, please, in Jesus' name, amen.
All that I know of his blessings. Washed clean and made whole was enough. But he's more than I ever imagined, more precious than silver or gold. Jesus is everything to me. He satisfies my longing soul. The half hasn't been told. This world can't contain just how good he is, how unworthy I am. Oh, praise his dear name. All that I heard, all that I know, doesn't compare or even come close. The half hasn't been told. So if you're searching for answers, unsure of what you should do, this world can't contain just how good he is, how unworthy I am. Oh, praise his dear name. All that I heard, all that I know, doesn't compare or even come close. The half hasn't been told. All that I heard, all that I know, doesn't compare or even come close. The half hasn't been told.
Amen. I appreciate that this morning. That ought to do something for your heart. And I'm not into this, you know, emotional thing. I want God to stir my heart for Him. And I like that. That's what that song does. And I appreciate that this morning so very much. As you can see tonight, this morning, we're talking about bound with chains. And I want to encourage you to be here tonight. 6 o'clock will be, Lord willing, back in our series of The Home. And I trust that it will be a help to you tonight at 6 o'clock. But this morning, as we just read Psalms chapter number 68, not only does this chapter, and of course the chapter's 35 verses, pretty lengthy, we didn't read the whole thing, but it not only exalts the Lord, but it gives a lot of reasons for His people to rejoice in God. In verses number 5 and 6, we see the tender care and deliverance of our God for those who seek Him. Now that's important. It's important to note that God meets the needs in a special way. Now the Bible does say that the rain falls on the just and the unjust. In other words, those who are not saved, the wicked people in society that hate God, despise Him, as the first few verses mention, God's still good to them. He still gives them breath of life. He still gives them eyesight and hearing. God has still shown His grace to them. But in a special way, for those who seek Him, God meets the needs for them. In a very special way, for those who are seeking Him, as opposed to those who are rebellious. Look in verse number 6, at the latter part of verse number 6. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land. The rebellious dry. Aren't you thankful that God uses illustrations that any culture can relate to? That any person really can relate to? We understand our food comes from crops. It comes from the ground. And wheat and so many different things. Obviously, you know that. But you can't have a productive crop. You're not going to have food on your table if the ground is so dry that there cannot be a productive crop. You've got to have some moist land. And God is using this as an illustration to say the rebellious dwell in a dry land. In other words, those who have a rebellious heart, those who choose not to seek after God, those who say, I know what God can do, but I'm not going to follow God, those who refuse to allow God to help them will not be fruitful or productive in spiritual matters. Now, we see how God does wonderful things for those that are His people. One of my commentators that I have in my office, a man that I study by, not exclusively, but I have a commentary set for many years now from John Phillips. And I like what John Phillips had to say. In verse number 5, John Phillips brought out that God is a refuge for the fatherless. Look at it in verse 5. He's a father to the fatherless. I'm thankful that when I trusted Christ as a 6-year-old boy, I realized I was a sinner. I realized I needed a Savior. I realized that what Jesus did on the cross wasn't just for Alan Dowles. It wasn't just for Brad Dawes. It was for Josh Boles. And I accepted Him and what He's done for me and asked Him to forgive me for being a sinner and coming to my heart. And He became my Father, my Heavenly Father, that takes care of me, that provides for me, that hears my prayer, just like I try to hear my children's cries for their needs. God is a refuge for the fatherless. John Phillips also in verse number 5 brought out that He is a respecter of the widows. In other words, He acknowledges them. He takes care of them. I appreciate the ministry of our church and how it has a heart in so many ways to look after the shut-ins and the widows of our church. Constantly calling, praying, having activities for them, whether it's a luncheon or inviting them to be at their home. So many things happen at Christmas, things happening at Valentine's Day, and I'm so very grateful for a church that cares for that, and that is a sign of true religion, as the Bible teaches us in the New Testament. So God is also, in verse number 6, a restorer of families, John Phillips said. In verse number 6, God setteth the solitary in families. And then also in verse number 6, he mentioned that He is a rescuer of those who are enslaved. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. Look in verse number 6 once again. He, that is God, bringeth out those which are bound with chains. And I would like to focus this morning on how God brings out those who are bound with chains. You see, everyone is not fatherless. Many in this room are. You've lost your dad, maybe at an early age, maybe at this stage of life, wherever you are, you've lost your dad. Maybe he was a good dad, maybe he wasn't such a good dad, but he was still your father and you still loved him because he was your dad. Not because of his actions, but you honored him because he was your dad, but you've lost him. You're now fatherless. But that's not everybody in this room. Raise your hand this morning if your dad is still alive. Raise your hand. Okay, so quite a few hands raised up. I'm thankful I have the opportunity, the privilege of my dad serving with me in the ministry. And I thank God for that. And so everyone is not fatherless. Everyone is not a widow. Raise your hand if you're not a widow in here. We have many widows, but we have many that are not. Everyone is not a widow. Everyone does not have a broken family. We have some wonderful families in our church, and I thank God for them. I thank God for every family. But everyone doesn't have a broken family. However, everyone can relate, as you'll see this morning, everyone can relate to being bound with chains. Every one of us can relate to being bound with chains. Number one, I want to share with you just three simple things this morning, and I trust that God will use it to be a help to each one of us. Number one, I want us to look at the description of chains. Again, in verse number 6, underscore, circle the word chains. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. Now, that may not be, it could be literal, But could it also be figurative? It could be an illustration. And I believe that's what God is talking about this morning. Chains, being bound with chains. It could be literal, but it also could be figurative. Chains are this morning, for the message this morning, are going to be an application for sin. An application for sin. Now, these chains could represent many things. These chains could represent oppression from Satan. The chains could represent depression. The chains could represent anxiety that so many people deal with in our culture today. Chains could really represent anything that binds you, that keeps you from being what God has created you to do. And so you can apply that in many ways, but this morning, by God's help, we're applying it for sin. John chapter 8, you can turn there if you want, but I'm going to read it pretty quick. If you don't want to turn, just listen carefully, write it down, look at it later. John chapter 8, verse 31, this is what Jesus said. Listen carefully. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall, get it, make you free. Now that's the opposite of being bound with chains, is it not? Goes on to Jesus in John 8:33. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed. We were never in bondage to any man. In other words, we're Jews. We have the promises of God, the blessings of God. We were never slaves, bondage, all of that. No. Bondage. Get that what they're saying. And they asked Jesus, how sayest thou you shall be made free? In verse 34, Jesus says, Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin. Whosoever committeth sin is the servant bound. A servant is bound to his master. Whosoever, Jesus says, commits sin is the servant of sins. So come here for a minute. Reason with me. And the Word of God. If I commit sin, if you commit sin, then I am becoming a servant to that sin based upon what Jesus told us. If I commit sin, I am become a servant to that sin, and it places me in bondage. It places, when I sin, when you sin, it places us in bondage. Walker, can you come here for a second? I like your pink tie. Some men can wear pink ties, some can't. You have to have big biceps to wear pink ties. My brother-in-law wears pink ties, and I've never said a word to him. He's about twice my size. If I wore pink ties, I would get beat up after church. And I'm joking. I like pink ties, and I have some that are borderline. Walker, I want you to sit over there, okay? And I've got some chains here. I'm going to really enjoy this. Walker, you don't realize this, but I've been bitter at you for a long time, buddy. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just picking, buddy. I love you. I'm just picking. Me and Walker have a good relationship. This is one of our finest young men, and we've had many, many fine young men. And so I'm going to put these chains around you, and Child Protection Services, this is not real chains. Okay. And these are plastic. They're not hurting you, are they?
They're plastic.
Yeah, they are. All right. So he's good, and you just sit back and relax because I'm going to have you there for quite a while. So Walker is going to have the chains on. And I want to say a couple things about being bound with chains, and that is every one of us have been in Walker's situation. Every one of us have been bound with chains, and it happens at birth. It happens at birth. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 12, listen carefully, in Romans chapter 5, verse number 12, wherefore as by one man's sin, who was that? Adam. He was the first man to sin against God. He and his wife kind of at the same time took a bite of that fruit from the tree of life, and God told them not to do it, and they did it. So the first sin really was disobedience. If you want to talk about Satan, he sinned, of course. First sin was pride. But the first man's sin was disobedience. And it goes on to say, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So our punishment for our sin is death. That's why people have to die. It's, yes, because of car wrecks and cancer and heart attack and all of that. And there's so many different areas of death. But the reason that we all must die at some point is because we're all sinners. And the Bible says, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. The first murder was Adam and Eve's children. It wasn't grandchildren. It was their children was the very first murder. Cain killed his brother Abel. The very first sin. And so that illustrates and helps us understand that Adam chose to sin. Romans 5:12 tells us. He and Eve chose to sin. But when he chose to sin, he became a sinner. It wasn't just because of he did one sin. He became a sinner. If you rob a bank, you are a bank robber. If you steal something, you become a thief. If you sin one time, you are a sinner. That's what God teaches us. And so death passed upon all men. What happened is when Adam and Eve had their children, they were born sinners. Don't you know that Adam and Eve regretted sinning against God? Don't you know that when they were taken out of that perfect Garden of Eden and an angel with a flaming sword kept anybody, including them, from coming back in there with the presence of God, don't you know that they looked back on that date and said, man, we messed up? Don't you know that they told their little infant Abel and little infant Cain, as they were rattling their little rattlers and barely talking and telling them how wonderful it was to walk with their Creator. How wonderful it was, and maybe they explained the image of God. Maybe they talked to them about how God was so caring and loving to them. No doubt they also told their little infant Cain and Abel, but yet God is a righteous God. And God is so holy and righteous that He cannot be around sin, and we messed up. It wasn't God's fault. Cain and Abel, it was me and your mother's. And now we're living outside of the presence of God. We cannot go to God now, not through bodily presence, because we've messed up. And we want you to make sure that you have your sins forgiven, because you're now a sinner. And you're now a sinner, and you've passed that on. And God has taught us that it's through the shedding of blood that we can have our sins forgiven. Don't you know they set them down and talked to them about that, and yet they still messed up? No, I believe with all of my heart, Adam and Eve didn't sit down and say, this is how you disobey God. You go try to eat that fruit over there. No, Adam and Eve were very sorry for their sin. But Cain and Abel had it in them. And that's why there's no sin 101 in college. There is no kindergarten or teacher that's going to teach their children to sin. They get enough of it already. They try to teach them, hey, here's the rules so you don't sin, so you don't create problems. Because we're all born with that sinful nature. In other words, we all come with this bondage of sin. Remember what Jesus said? It's sin. And not only that, but now a person that has been saved even chooses to sin. And we'll get to this in just a few moments more so. But not only do we come or we're born with chains of sin, but we choose chains of sin. Don't raise your hand. Please. Nobody raise your hand. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever chose to sin? You knew it wasn't right, but you choose to do it anyway. You choose to lie. You choose to cheat. You choose to do whatever is in your heart and mind. You've chose to do it, whether it's big or small. There's no sin category degrees in God's eyes. Sin is sin. Right is right, wrong is wrong. And all God's people said, I hope we understand that. I'm not like that guy. Well, to God, it doesn't matter. We categorize it if you do some sins, you're going to prison, and you should. Because we don't want you in our society with us, right? But sin is sin with God. And we've all chose to sin in our lives. So not only were we born with chains of sin, we have chosen to cause ourselves to be in bondage because of the sin that we chose to do. So there's the description. Now, I want you to notice very carefully this morning the destruction of the chains. Not only the description of what these chains mean, but the destruction of it. Look in verse number 6. We've already underscored or circled the word chains, but this time I want you to underscore or look at or circle the word bound. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. Do you know what chains do? Chains of sin bind us from freedom. I go back to what Jesus mentioned in John chapter 8, verse number 32. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Free from what? Free from the bondage of sin. Chains of sin bind us from freedom. For those who have never trusted Jesus as their personal Savior, this is what is going on. You may not have this appearance as Walker does, but you've got chains of bondage because you know what? Guess what? That sin that you're born with, you may be a very moral person, and I applaud you for that. You're to be commended for that. But you've still have to admit that at some point in your life, you've messed up. You've made a decision. You've lied to your parents as a five-year-old. You've disobeyed someone somewhere, somehow. You may not do this, this, and this, but you have sinned against a holy, righteous God who's never sinned, and that sin is binding you from a place called heaven. Because just like Adam and Eve could not stay there in the presence of God as a sinner, neither can you and I get to heaven with sin. If there was one drop of sin in heaven, it would not be a perfect place anymore. But I want to tell you, I've read the Bible and I find that there is no tears in heaven. There is no problems in heaven. There is rejoicing in heaven. You know what that tells me right there? There's no sin. Because sin is the thing that causes, it's the root of the tears of sorrow. It's the weeping. It's the root of all the anxiety and the problems of life is because of sin to some degree, whether it's outsourced or insourced. Sin is a big problem. And friend, if you've never trusted Christ as your personal Savior, it will keep you from going to heaven for all eternity. And it will bind you to a place called hell. The chains of sin not only bind us from freedom, but secondly, the chains of sin bind us from fellowship. Now I'm going to read to you, and I want you to listen very carefully because I'm reading it a lot. You can turn with me if you want, or write it down, look at it when you get home. But 1 John chapter 1 and verses 5, 6, and 7 say this. Listen carefully. In the New Testament it says, "This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all." In other words, there's no sin in God. Verse 6, if we say, the Apostle John is speaking here, who leaned on Jesus' breast, who leaned on his shoulder, who communed with him, who spoke with him, who was with Jesus often during Jesus' earthly ministry. He's one writing this. He says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light and have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Those of us who are saved have a relationship with God the Father. Aren't you thankful for that? Not only do we have a relationship because of our being born again, as I have a relationship with my dad because I was born to the Boles family, but we also enjoy this thing called fellowship. Communion. In other words, God, when I read his word to me, he speaks to my heart. I understand it. It comforts me. As a dad would put his arm around his little child at night and say, through this thunderstorm, everything's going to be okay. That's what the word of God does for me. Sometimes a dad will have to challenge their children, take a step of faith. You need to do that. It'll help you. It'll encourage you. Try out for the team. You need to do this. And God, as I read his word, challenges us. Does he not? So many things God, our Father, does for us. And as I read it, I have not only that relationship that never changes, but I have sweet fellowship with him, not only through this book, but through prayer. And I call out to God when I'm having issues, and I say, God, man, I'm overwhelmed right now. And I need you because I'm struggling. Because it seems like my world is falling in from the roof down, all crushing around my soul. Lord, I am in desperate need of you. I need you now more than ever before. And you know what? His sweet presence and the fellowship of God is so sweet and cannot be replaced with any other person. My wife is a big help to me. Big help to me. Sometimes she puts her arm around me and says, I love you, and everything's going to be okay. Sometimes she says, man up. Get over it. Not like that. But she encourages me, and she says, listen, it's going to be okay. Wake up. God's in control. You know, not like that. But she does encourage me, and she's a big help to me. But listen, there's nothing my wife cannot, though we're one in marriage, one flesh, as God tells us. Yet she cannot take that sweet fellowship. She cannot take the place of that sweet fellowship with God in Bible reading and prayer. But the Bible says, I just read it in 1 John chapter 1, verse number 6, that if we are walking in darkness, if we're allowing some sin to enter our life, it doesn't remove or affect the relationship, but it affects the fellowship. And there's so many Christians in America today that say, well, I have liberty to do this, and I have liberty to do that, and I can kind of do whatever I want, and they're dabbling in sin, things that God says don't do, and they're dabbling in that. And they say, I have sweet fellowship with God. The Bible says it's a lie. Because you can't walk in darkness. You can't sin and do whatever you want and say, I have sweet communion with God. You're going up against what God has said. And we wonder why we're going to church, but our lives are a mess at home. It's because we're missing that fellowship, because we've chosen to wear the chains of bondage. And when you wear chains of sin, it's going to bind you from fellowship with God. Not only that, but chains of sin bind us from the furtherance of the gospel. Now, I want to read to you again, and I want you to listen very carefully. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 8, write it down. Look at it when you get home. 1 Corinthians 8, verse number 8 through 13. Listen very carefully. Sometimes I feel like I lose people when I read verses because we lose eye contact. So I want you to stay with me. The Bible says, but meat commendeth us not to God, for neither if we eat are we better, neither if we eat not are we the worse. But take heed, lest any man means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak. For if any man see thee which hast knowledge sit at meat within the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish from whom Christ died. But when ye sin so against the brethren, and wound their weak conscience, ye sin against Christ. Christians is who's talked to. Verse 13 says this, wherefore, if any meat make my brother to offend, I will eat no flesh while the world standeth, lest I make my brother to offend. You say, Pastor, please tell me what that means. I'm glad you asked. I'm going to tell you what it means. Here we go. Paul, the Apostle Paul, is being inspired of God to help people, Christians in the church. And you understand that in New Testament, they're coming out of the Old Testament law, and they have liberty now. They don't have to keep the Old Testament ritual. That's why we're not worshiping on Saturday, because we're in the New Testament. Our lives are not based upon the law of the Old Testament, but Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ rose the first day of the week. Okay, is everybody with me? And we're not keeping, that's just one illustration of many. We're not bound to keep the law. Are the Ten Commandments good to abide by? You better believe it. But we're not bound to those things. It's further than that. Now, I don't have to look at Exodus chapter 20 and the Ten Commandments and say, well, I hope I'm keeping this, and I'll make sure you're keeping this, and honey, you better keep this, and children, you better keep this. No, because we're saved and we have a relationship with God through Christ, now we say, man, I want to do that. You don't have to give me the list. It's in my heart. I want to do something for Jesus. I don't want to do that because it would hurt my Father and that fellowship. And so it's totally different now. But Paul is writing here, and he's explaining this, that because we're coming out of the law, some people still feel like, yeah, I'm saved, but I still got to do these things. And Paul is saying to basically them, basically he's saying, get along. And basically he's saying, listen, you do what you feel like God would have you to do. But this is what he says in verse number 13. If I, as a child of God, have liberty in some type of area, and I know that I'm not bound by the law to do it, and I can eat pork, and I can do these things, and I can do whatever and still keep my heart right with God, but I'm just not bound to the law. But if my brother who just got saved, he's struggling with that. He doesn't understand. He has not grown in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ to the point to understand that he can let that go. He says, I will not do some things because I do not want my brother to be offended. Because he says in the prior verse, he says, because if you do that, if you do whatever you want, and another Christian brother or sister in Christ sees that, you know what's going to happen? That's going to offend them. And here's what's happening. I'm going somewhere with this, but here's what's happening. A lot of Christians today say, well, I have liberty in Christ and I can kind of do whatever I want. And other Christians are just getting saved. They're looking at that and they're saying, wait a minute, and it's getting out of hand to the point that I can do whatever I want because of the grace of God and I can kind of do whatever I want. But what's happening is there's people looking at that and saying, the Bible tells us not to do that. And it's causing offense in another brother or sister's eyes. But here's where I'm going with this. The application of that is for the furtherance of the gospel. Come here for a minute. There are people, I don't like to admit this. I'm just going to be honest with you. I do not like to admit it, but it's true, so I'm going to tell you. There are people that know more about the Bible than your pastor does, and they're not even saved. They're not even saved. They don't go to church, but they've read it. And they can quote it more than I can quote it because they studied it. Now, they've never chosen to trust Christ as their personal Savior, and that's very unfortunate. They've got a head knowledge, and they've never allowed it to affect their heart. It's all stuck here. You say, well, what happened to that person? Well, they'll have to perish in a place called hell one day because that with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. And so they've got to allow God to work in their heart, and they've got to seek God for forgiveness. But what I set out to say, there's a lot of people in the world today, especially in America, especially in the southeast of our country, especially in the Bible Belt, especially on the shiny of the buckle of the Bible Belt where we live, there are a lot of people that know this book and probably better than you and I, but they've never trusted Christ, but they're watching you to see if it's really real. And what you post on Facebook and the way you live your life, they're watching that. And if they're saying that doesn't line up with the Word of God, you know what? It's offending them. And that's where we get the hypocritical type of slang and cliche that we get. Well, I'm not going to ever go to church. I'm not going to ever be a Christian because there's a bunch of hypocrites there. Well, they should. You say, well, they shouldn't be looking at people because we mess up and we make mistakes. And they should be looking at Jesus instead of man. You're exactly right. But with God's help, I'm not, by God's grace and His help, I am not going to allow myself to become a stumbling block to someone because I've allowed chains of sin to keep me from helping the furtherance of the gospel. I am not perfect. I mess up. And if you do not give me grace, then you will get offended. I will step on your toes. I will never mean to hurt you or offend you, but I promise you, I am human. Some of you are thinking, what? Yes, I am human. And I think sometimes I'm tired, and sometimes I get cranky, believe it or not. And sometimes I don't always shake somebody's hand that I should have, and I don't always mention somebody that I should have, and I make mistakes, and you've got to give me some grace. We've got to give each other grace. We've got to overlook some things, not problems and sins and stuff like that, but just nitpicking stuff, you got to do that. And you're so wonderful at that, and I thank God for that. But may God help us with that. Number four, I'm almost done. Chains of sin bind us from fruitfulness. If you have your Bible, would you turn with me, please, quickly? I understand the time, but I'm looking at my conclusion at the same page, okay? Galatians chapter 5. I want you to turn with me there. Galatians chapter number 5. Here in just a minute, you don't want to miss. We're going to take these chains off Walker. Oh, happy day, happy day. Jesus washed my sins away. And Walker's already saved, but we're going to take those sins out. Chains up. Galatians chapter 5, look with me, please. Very familiar, it should be very familiar to every Christian in here. If this is not familiar, I hope you'll make it familiar for you. Galatians chapter 5, look with me in verse number 17. Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. The Bible says, for the flesh... That's the old person that never got saved. That's our tongue and our lips and our eyes and our ears and our brain that never got saved. When you get to heaven, you get a new body. Your body doesn't go to heaven. That's why it's in the casket when somebody dies. Their soul's with the Lord, but their body's still here going to the dust of the ground. That's the flesh. It's not saved. It makes mistakes. And there's a war there between our spirit and our flesh. Let's read about it. For the flesh, verse 17, lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led of the spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Notice what the flesh does. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. This is not a Bible study on this passage. Some of these I would love to define, but let's continue reading for sake of time. Verse 21, envyings. You know enough of these to know they're a bunch of bad things. Envyings, murderers. I think it's fascinating that all these are grouped into one category and the vast different areas they are, though. Murders, drunkenness, revilings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. In other words, if you're living in that kind of lifestyle and there's no conviction, and then it's obvious that you're not saved, okay? If this is your way of life, this is a categorized of you. But I want you to notice in verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Now, that verse 22 and verse 23 is the fruit of the Spirit. In other words, if I am doing if I'm walking in the Spirit and doing what God would have me to do based upon the Word of God, I'm going to see some of this from my life. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. Some of these are inward, like love, joy, peace. Some of these are outward to my fellow men, like gentleness, long-suffering, which means patience, meekness, humbleness towards other people. But what it comes down to is I can choose to walk in the flesh, and I'm going to live just like somebody who's not saved. These are the works of the flesh, the bad things, the murders, the drunkenness, all of that we just read. Those are the results from walking in the flesh, just like somebody who's not saved. Or I can walk in the Spirit and experience love, joy, and peace. But come here for a minute. When you have chains of sin, when you've chosen to sin, even as a believer, you're in that chains of sin is binding you from having fruitfulness in your life. There's a lot of people who have no joy, they have no peace, and they're children of God. They've been saved. But they've allowed sin to creep in, whether it's bitterness, jealousy, hatred, something simple. But now it's dictating their life in such a way they're in bondage. How sad. Number three, and we're done, the deliverance. Notice again in verse 6 of Psalms chapter 68. Psalms chapter 68, verse number 6, He bringeth out. Who's that? God. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. You know how God does that? He does that through forgiveness. God is a righteous God, and He has the ability to forgive. He is not the trespasser. We are the trespasser. We are the guilty. He is not. We are the ones that come to Him with chains of bondage, and we say, I don't like this. It's keeping me from freedom. It's keeping me from fellowship. It's keeping me from the furtherance of the gospel. It's keeping me from having fruit from my life. It's hindering my marriages. It's causing problems with my home. It's causing problems with my coworkers. I've got to get out of this bondage. And God says, okay, I'm the one that can do it. You've came to the right place. It is He. Verse number 6, circle the word He. Underline it. He bringeth out those which are bound with chains. The Father, Jesus is the one and the only one that can do it. I can't do it for you. Your wife can't do it. Your husband can't do it. Your children can't do it. A promotion at job is not going to do it. A relocation is not going to do it. But God can deliver you from the bondage of chains, friend. God can, and He does. But it's your responsibility. What does, again, verse number 6 say? The rebellious. Those who say, I don't really like this, but I'm not about to go to God. They're the ones who are dwelling in a dry land. They're the ones who are not getting any fruit. There's no joy. There's no peace. There's no fellowship with God. There's a relationship there because they're saved, but there's no fellowship there. They're having problems in every other area because of the bondage of the chains as a result of the sin. But God forgives you. If you're here this morning, you've never trusted Christ, your Savior, God can forgive you for being a sinner. God is not interested, come here for a minute, God is not interested in forgiving you for this sin that you did when you were 13, and this sin when you did when you were 17, and this sin when you did when you were 31, and this sin you did when you were 48. God is not interested in that. God is saying, you are a sinner. You do those sins because you are a sinner. I want to forgive you for being a sinner. God says, I want to take care of it all at one time. It's not forgiving you for this as a sinner. It's because of who you are, which you chose to do. Romans chapter 6, verse 17 says, but God be thanked that you were the servants of sin. You were in bondage, in chains of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. You know what that means? We heard that Jesus loved us and died for us. We heard that he was buried and rose again. And we realized that, you know what, I'm in chains of sin, and that's keeping me from going to heaven. But I believe what Jesus has done for me. You call upon, you say, Lord, please forgive me for being a sinner. Take me to heaven. You know what God does? He reaches down and says, okay. Amen. Raise your hand. Don't get up yet. Raise your hand. Getting saved is not based on feelings. It's based off faith. But after you got saved, raise your hand if it felt pretty good. That's enough to come back to church on Sunday night for. That's enough to come back to church on Wednesday night. And if you've got over that, you need to get back to that and remember what Jesus has done for you. Wait a minute. Maybe you're here and you're like Walker. You're saved. As far as I know, Walker's perfect. The laughing is not good. As far as I know, Walker's is perfect. But let's say Walker's a saved person. He's trusted Christ. And he's been saved for maybe 10, 20 years. And he's allowed some enviness, some bitterness. He's been looking at the wrong things on the internet. He's got some wrong thoughts and feelings in his heart towards others. He's in chains of sin. Now, he's going to heaven. But his life is miserable because he's a child of God. But he knows down deep in his heart he's hindering other people from getting saved. He knows down deep in his heart he has no fellowship with God. He can come to church and smile from ear to ear and wave his hand and say, praise the Lord, but he knows down deep in his heart he's bound with sin. Aren't you thankful for 1 John 1:9? If we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Where are you at today? Are you free from bonds of sin because the Master forgive you? Are you got this sin on you? Walker, you can be seated. Thank you, buddy. You got these chains of sin on you? Listen, there's a reason that's in the Bible. A lot of people, you can't see these chains, but they're all over people. Whether you're not saved or whether you're saved and you're living in sin, come to Jesus. He can forgive you. But he's the only one. It's not going to come through a 13-week new member course. It's not going to come through even baptism. It is not going to come through whatever, reading your Bible through. It's going to come through confession. Whether you're a sinner and say, I need to be saved, or whether you're a saved person and say, I got to get this right. Come to Jesus. Bow your head and close your eyes. Let's all stand together. With heads are bowed and eyes are closed, we're all standing to our feet. Our musicians are coming. They're going to play a verse on the instruments. The altar's open, and I encourage you, if God has spoke to your heart about something, to use the altar, to respond to what the Holy Spirit has done in your heart. And as our instrumentalists begin playing very softly, I want to ask you this morning, with heads bowed and eyes are closed, if you say, Pastor, I know for sure I'm saved. I know without a doubt that I know I've called upon the Lord for salvation. I'm not ashamed of that. Would you simply raise your hand and say, I'm not ashamed. I thank God I'm saved. Okay, thank you. I see hands all over. I appreciate that. I wonder if you're here this morning, you say, Pastor, I've never done that. I know I need to. I got that head knowledge, but I've never called upon Jesus for salvation. I'm not going to call your name or I'm not going to come to you, but I would love to pray for you in my private time with God. Would you simply raise your hand right now if you say, Pastor, pray for me that I would make that decision to get saved. Would you do that right now? Would you lift up your hand, hold it there for just a minute, and say, Pastor, please pray for me that I would make the decision to trust Christ as my Savior. All right. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand about this question. I just want you to respond. Brother Holly's getting ready to sing, and as he leads us in a verse, if God has spoke to your heart, I want you to come and say, Lord, help me. Forgive me. whatever the situation is, I don't know what's going on in your life. I have no clue. But I do know this. God put that on my heart for something, some reason. It's not really an encouraging message. It's not really a motivating message. I like those. This is kind of a dealing with the issue message. And I don't really care for those. I'm just going to be honest. I don't really care for those much. But they're desperately needed. And the Lord placed, put it on my heart for a purpose. As Brother Holly sings, would you come right now? Think about the words that we're singing.
Come, I want you to come. Every soul, my sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word.
In our hearts through your word. Lord, I pray that you would help us to give heed to that. Help us to implement your word, Father, in every area. Help us to keep our heart clean. Lord, help us not to slip into that. If we are saved, Lord, Help us not to slip in that bondage type of situation where we have no fruit, there's no enjoyment of the Christian life. Lord, help us with that. Lord, I pray that you would help those perhaps in the service who are not saved. They would make that decision to trust Christ. Maybe they'd see my wife or myself or someone after the service about getting saved, trusting Christ as their Savior before they leave the campus today. We'll thank you for what you do in their lives, in our hearts, in Jesus' name. We're going to sing one more verse as folks are still being dealt with and helped. Let's sing this one verse together. Sing it out from your hearts now.
Come every soul, my sin oppressed, there's mercy.
Share some video announcements with you. These will take about a minute and a half and or so. And so listen carefully. There's a lot coming up and I want you to be a part of these things. So listen carefully and then we'll be dismissed this morning.
Thank you for joining us this morning here at Temple for our morning worship service. If you're visiting with us today, we trust the service has been a blessing to you and hope that you are able to be with us again very soon. We would like to remind you of a few upcoming events.
Our next Young Adult Fellowship will be an activity at the Party Shack in Greensboro on Saturday, March 23rd. If you're between the ages of 19 and 49, make plans now to join us for this wonderful time of fellowship and encouragement. For any questions, please see Pastor or Mrs. Boles.
Our annual chili cook-off is coming up next Sunday, February 25th, following the evening service in our Heritage Hall. Our entire church family is invited to be a part of this fun time of fellowship and meal together. If you would like to participate in the competition, please see the sign-up sheet today located in the entryway.
The ladies of our church will be attending the Freedom Ladies Conference on Saturday, March 9th in Rural Hall. This is always a wonderful day of spiritual encouragement for each attendee. If you would like to participate in this event, please see the sign-up sheet located by the media desk. You may also register online. We hope each lady can join us for this enjoyable time together.
Our next teen activity will be on Saturday, March 16th. We are looking forward to this free on-campus event that will include a nacho bar for dinner, as well as games of life-size Clue and Grog. For any questions, please see Brother or Mrs. Holly.
We are very excited about our Easter services this year on Sunday, March 31st. Make plans now and begin inviting others to be with us as we celebrate the resurrection of our Savior. We are also looking forward to an annual Easter Spectacular on Saturday, March 30th from 11 to 1. A sign-up sheet will be available soon for those who would like to volunteer to help with this fun event. Let's pray together for God's many blessings upon this upcoming special weekend.
Join us this Wednesday at 7 p.m. as we continue a brand new series in studying the books of 1st and 2nd Peter. We are also looking forward to our regular teen and Kids for Truth programs, as well as our outreach ministry at 5 p.m.
Thank you once again for joining us this morning. We would like to invite each family to be back with us again this evening at 6 o'clock p.m. for uplifting singing, as well as another helpful Bible message that will strengthen us spiritually.
All right, let's all stand together once again. I want to encourage each one to be a part of these events. Most of them, if not all of them, are in the bulletin, as well as many other things. And so please keep all these things in mind. I love you. Thank you for being here. Visitors, thank you for being with us. Turn around, shake a hand or two. God bless you. You're dismissed. See you tonight, 6 o'clock, choir practice at 5. God bless you.